I want to continue my talk about the illustrated background or illustrated activities of the great master of Mount Koya. This is a 14th century illustrated group of scrolls called Koya Daishi Gyojo Zue, which is preserved in Volume 8 of Kobodaishi Den Zenshu. That means Kobodaishi or Kukai's Den means biography, and Zenshu means complete collection. Some of the illustrations I'm showing you come from the National Literature Research Museum. They're designated National Treasure, Important Cultural Property, Artwork. There's a copy held in the Hakuzura Fine Art Museum, which is the Hakuzura Bijutsukan. There's also copies held at Koya-san Museum, that's Mount Koya Museum, and at the Tokyo National Museum, among other places. As I mentioned last time, there are several varieties of Kukai illustrated biographies. There's 6-volume version, there's a 10-volume version or versions, there's 12-volume versions. This 10-volume version is an example of the most popular type. It's believed to be the oldest of the complete set of 10 volumes extant. As far as I know, there have been no academic treatment or any other treatment of these historic scrolls in English. So lucky you, but seriously, if you're interested in doing some art historical research about Buddhism in Japan or Japanese illustrated scrolls, this might be a good project for you. At the beginning of the first volume, there's an attached document that says it was made in the year 1319. The artist's name is listed as Koseno Tomoyasu, who is unknown elsewhere. While Koseno is considered to be the artist of these paintings, it's also the name of 7 other people, along with dates, mostly around the same year. The dates are 1319, 1325, 1312, 1343, and 1506. These are found in the headings of the narrative text in the various scrolls, that is, the narrative versus the illustrations. So each of the illustrations have a narrative beside it. The version that I'm showing you is from a printed book. The scrolls were, of course, rolled up, but facsimile photographs were made of them and put into book form. So last time I talked about the first scroll, I showed you 11 entries in the first scroll. Let's move on to the second scroll. The first illustration of the second scroll is titled Tengu Question and Answer. It's also at Muroto, that's where Kukai used to meditate, in the island of Shikoku. It also says, gets rid of Tengu, Kongo Choji Temple, which is temple number 26 in the Shikoku pilgrimage to 88 temples. Tengu is a type of demon, you might say. It's a yokai. There are several theories about where Tengu come from, but generally speaking, yokai, according to modern scholarship, yokai are monstrous representations of some people that Yamato people didn't like. In other words, marginalized people. One theory holds that the long nose of a Tengu is based on non-Japanese people, particularly Europeans, who maybe had noses that were perceived as being bigger than Japanese people's noses usually are. It's one theory. Kongo Choji Temple in Shikoku has this to say about this incident, and I mean today, modern day, on the internet, they have this to say. After completing training in the cave of Muroto, Kukai built Kongo Choji Temple in 807, and this later became the 26th temple in the Shikoku pilgrimage. After he completed his training in the cave, he continued to train some more there at the temple he built. The old legend says he banished some demons, and this legend's different from today's temple legend. According to the old legend, Tengu often appeared around this area, harming people. Kukai saw this and used his Dharma powers to defeat the Tengu in debate and then drive them out to sea, some say to Cape Ashizuri, which is at the southern tip of Shikoku. After this, Kukai arranged things there at the temple so that the Tengu would not come back and do mischief. For example, the entrance of the Daishido or Kukai Hall at this Shikoku temple complex faces out to sea. So in the Shikoku pilgrimage, the 88 temples in Shikoku, the temple grounds have 2 halls. One of them is the main hall, and it houses a Buddhist image, usually a Buddha or a Bodhisattva, typically a Buddha. And then there's a second hall that's the Kukai Hall called Daishido, the Daishi Hall. and it houses a image of Kukai. So pilgrims go to both of these halls when they visit each of the 88 temples in Shikoku. And at this particular temple, the entrance of the Daishi Hall faces out to the sea. Usually in the Shikoku pilgrimage, the Daishi Hall entrance faces the direction of the main hall. But in this case, it's arranged facing the sea so that the power of Kukai keeps the Tengu away out in the sea. In other words, Kukai is keeping an eye in the direction of the sea. It's also said that after Kukai did this, he defeated the Tengu in a debate, that the Tengu changed and started being friendly to the people and didn't do any harm. That's another legend that was introduced. Now, I wanted to mention another thing about Tengu and where this legend might have come from, although this is not part of the legend today. Folklorists who do studies of yokai are demons and monsters in Japanese folklore, say that Tengu is a particular type of these demons that may have developed or evolved from the ideas of heretical mountain priests or people with different religious ideas. So there were, for example, Shugendo. Shugendo are mountain ascetics who aren't necessarily a part of any religious sect, but they do practices on their own in the mountains. Because these people were considered dangerous in society because they were outside the control of the Buddhist temples and the government, they were represented as demon-like. If this is what's going on in this story, or at least was at one time what was going on in this story, that these heretical priests were hanging around this area bothering the people, supposedly, and Kukai defeated them in debate and ran them off, that makes sense of why the story might have been created. Another story, and this one too is posted on the temple website today, says that the demons of the Tengu were inhabiting a large tree in the area when Kukai arrived, and that he chased them away and carved a statue from the tree, and the statue supposedly still remains at the Daishido today. Today there's also a belief that it was not Tengu that he chased away, but a dragon. The second illustration is of the East Pagoda of Kumedera Temple in Nara. And this is when Kukai finds the Dainichi Kyo, which is the Mahavarachana Sutra, an esoteric scripture. He finds it in the east tower of that temple. According to various legends and different documents, Kukai was either informed that there was an esoteric scripture that might help him on his quest to understand esoteric Buddhism, or he dreamed it. So one legend said he had a dream that the Dainichi Kyo was in this temple, and he went there and he found it. The third illustration says that Kukai prays for safe crossing of the sea, and he creates a Yakushin Norai, which is a medicine Buddha statue. And he prays for safety to go to Tong China. The fourth illustration is that Kukai gets imperial sanction to go to China. It was rather a struggle, at least this is the way it's presented in Kukai's biography, for him to be approved to go to China. That Saicho, who is the founder of the Tendai school, was chosen and asked to go to China, and Saicho didn't necessarily want to go at first, but on the other hand, Kukai did want to go as a study abroad student, but he had to get approval because Kukai didn't have the connections needed. But maybe his uncle Otto helped. Kukai will go to China, according to the inscription here, and he will leave Higo Tanoura in Nagasaki Prefecture of Kyushu with an ambassador. Illustration number 5, arrival in Tong, docks at Fuzhou, present to the secretary because he wrote in place of the ambassador. The story says that Kukai's ship was blown off course, and instead of going straight to the capital like Saicho did in his ship, that he landed in Fuzhou and that he was detained there for several months. And finally, Kukai wrote a letter to a government official. The ambassador on board the boat with Kukai usually wrote the letters, but Kukai was asked to write this letter, and he wrote it in such a beautiful calligraphic handscript, and also the words that he wrote was so poetic, allegedly, that the secretary recognized Kukai as a great person and allowed the party now to come off the boat and go to the capital, Chang'an. The reason they were detained is because at the time there were spies and they weren't sure that the outsiders were trustworthy. Illustration number 6. Enters Chang'an with the ambassador on a horse decorated with a saddle of 7 kinds of treasures. Illustration number 7. 5 brushes, imperial decree, in Tang China. Kukai writes on the wall of the palace with a brush in his left hand, his right hand, his left foot, right foot, and in his mouth. This kind of mythology, as well as we'll see in number 8 coming up, I think has to do with the nature of language, because Kukai is extremely interested in language, extremely interested in mantra, and interested in intuiting or feeling or coming to understand through esoteric means what the universe is trying to say to us. Number 8. Writing characters in the air, writing letters on the flowing water with the boy Manjushri. Manjushri was a disciple of Buddha, and according to this hagiography, he reincarnated as a boy and recognized Kukai as the future master of esoteric Buddhism and asked Kukai to exchange writing with him. This story also appears in the Konjaku Monogatari that I mentioned to you earlier, the collection of stories from India, China, and Japan. That's the end of the illustrations in scroll number 2. Scroll number 3, the first illustration, shows crosses heaven, sees Buddha, led by a wonder child, goes to Vulture Peak in India, listens to Buddha's Dharma explanations. So if I were to interpret this, I would say it has to do with making a connection. We talked about making a connection in my last lecture, that according to Buddhism, all people have to have a connection to a previous Buddhist. The Buddha in his previous lives met the previous Buddhas, and because of that connection, he's able to become a Buddha. My guess is that's where this story comes from, and that's the meaning behind the story of Kukai going to heaven and meeting the Buddha. I might add that the Buddha should be extinct, parinirvana. Illustration number 2. Kukai enters a temple in Tong, enters Eastern Pagoda Hall of Green Dragon Temple, and receives the Kanjo, that is esoteric sprinkling of water, it's an initiation, of the dual mandala from Master Hui Go. Illustration number 3. Zhenhe's deep-seated grudge. Xunzhao's disciple, Xinhe, has resentment about Kukai receiving the Dharma of both mandala from Hui Go. Illustration number 4. Shubin defense Dharma. Shubin of Kofukuji Temple, which is a Hoso or Yogacara temple in Nara, becomes jealous over Kukai receiving the defense dharma, that is, religious power to dispel demons and diseases. I'm not sure why this picture's here, because Shubin's from Japan. I suppose Shubin might be in China. I'll have to look into this more. Illustration number 5. Inheritance of ritual instruments from Wei Go. In anticipation of his death, Wei Go bestows worn-patched hermit robe, that is the Kasaya, or the monk's stole. In Buddhism, this is symbolic. When a master bestows his robe or her robe onto the student, that means that student is the new master. Certainly, this is controversial because while Japan believes that Kukai inherited the ability to be the master, other places have written that Hui Go said that Kukai should take the Dharma to Japan and be the master there, while his other students take it to other parts of the world. Illustration number 6. Hui Go's death. Osho Hui Go, the night of his passing, gives dying instructions to Kukai. So I have what Kukai wrote about that. I translated it and can provide you a link if you're interested in reading that document. I analyzed it along with Chanju Moon, who used to teach at Coastal, and we published it in a journal called The Eastern Buddhist. Illustration number 7. Hui Go enters Nuzhou. Kukai receives deathbed instructions. Nuzhou is basically parinirvana, the final death or final nirvana of a master. But Nuzhou literally means inner samadhi. This is important later when Kukai enter samadhi or anujo because his followers believe he didn't die, he just entered long-term samadhi. But this illustration, Kukai's Chinese master Huigo enters nujo. Number 8, throws the three-pronged vajra towards Japan. According to legend, Kukai stood on a shore in China when he was about to return to Japan, and he threw his three-pronged vajra up into the air towards Japan from China while praying that it might show him the way in the future to where he can build a center for esoteric Buddhism in Japan. The vajra disappeared into the sky. Then years later, in 816, when Kukai went in search of the vajra up in the mountains, he met a hunter who had two dogs with him, a white dog and a black dog, which almost certainly means yin and yang. And the hunter became his guide, and they took Kukai up to a place where he said he saw something in a tree that was sparkling. And there, supposedly in Mount Koya, Kukai found his vajra hanging from a three-needled pine tree. Ordinary pines in Japan have two needles. So this is a special pine tree, a three-needle pine. And the three needles, of course, represent his three-pronged vajra. Today at Mount Koya, one of the tourist attractions is the offspring of that tree. There's a three-needle pine in Mount Koya that has a little fence around it, a low fence, and tourists go there and look through the pine needles that are on the ground and try to find a three-needled pine. I want to show you this TV commercial that ran in Japan, and it's an advertisement for tourists to visit Mount Koya. As I mentioned before, there's a saying in Japan, of course promoted by the tourist industry, that all Japanese people should visit Mount Koya at least once in their lifetimes. Number 9, Kukai returns to Japan and presents an encyclopedia to the imperial court, an encyclopedia that tells all the scriptures and all of the esoteric instruments and everything else that he brought back from China. The fourth scroll has 8 illustrations. The first one shows Kukai's return to Japan and presenting the materials that he imported to Emperor Heijo in the year 806. The last one in the previous scroll showed that Kukai returned to Japan and brought these items with him, but now in the fourth scroll he presents them to the emperor. Emperor Heijo tells Kukai he wants him to think about propagating the Shingon Dharma, and after that, in the year 810, the new emperor, Emperor Saga, calls for Kukai to return to the capital and start propagating Shingon. The second illustration shows New Year's greeting a live tree, and this is at Usa Jingu, Usa Shrine. Kukai gives thanks for the new year at the shrine for the divine protection that he received in Tang China. Saicho also prayed at Usa Jingu that year for protection he received in China. The third illustration shows Kukai facing west and sprinkling water, and this is to give distant solace for a fire calamity that happened at Qinglong Temple, where Kukai had stayed in China. The fourth illustration shows Kukai's pilgrimage to a temple to visit Prince Shotoku Mausoleum in Kawachi Province in Japan, in the eastern part of modern-day Osaka Prefecture. This is the basis of the ancient Fuji clan from China that lived in Japan. Prince Shotoku was founder of Japanese Buddhism. People call him the father of Japanese Buddhism, and this shows that Kukai is paying respect to that founder. The fifth illustration shows Kukai manifests the power to become a Buddha. He transforms into a golden Dainichi Norai, that's Mahavarachana, as he's sitting in debate of doctrine with other Buddhist scholar priests. The sixth illustration shows Kukai builds a religious fire and brings forth water. He chants a Dharani mantra at Makiosan Temple in Izumo, where he had entered Buddhism under Gonzo, his Japanese master, and spring water gushes forth. He also attaches a hinoki leaf to a camellia tree. The seventh illustration shows that Kukai gives the kanjo, that's the esoteric baptism, or abhisheka is called in Sanskrit, the initiation where you sprinkle water over somebody. It seems that initiation might be related to coronation of a king, because around the same time in Asia, a king was coronated with sprinkling water. and this takes place at Takaoyama. Saicho was the founder of the Tendai school, a rival school during the Heian period, but the fact that Kukai gave him the initiation means Kukai is his master, although history doesn't see it this way. History sees Kukai and Saicho as rivals. The eighth illustration, river drawing. For the flood at the Kiyotaki River, Kiyotakigawa, Kukai draws or paints the characters for the name of the temple. The story says that Kukai wasn't able to cross the river, and so he drew in the air, and through the magical power, it wrote on the temple placard across the river. Some people have pointed out that this was a magic trick that was popular in China at the time, and it may be where this legend comes from. The fifth scroll has 12 illustrations. The first one is of Hachiman invitation. Hachiman is a popular Shinto kami, that is, a spirit of nature. Hachiman is also the god of war. This shows that Kukai has syncretism between Shingon, or between Buddhism in general, and Shinto. Kukai is famous for this syncretism, pulling together these two religions. In this illustration, what's going on is the syncretism of Hachiman and the Daibutsu, the big Buddha, at Todaiji Temple in Nara, the central gate, which takes place in the year 823. Kukai prayed for Hachiman in a ceremony that transfers the power of this deity into a new location. The second illustration in this fifth scroll is called Inari Alliance, or hospitality for the Kami Inari, who visited Toji Temple and was enshrined on the eastern mountain there by Kukai. Inari's very popular today, as Hachiman is in Shinto. Inari is the kami that is the protector of rice, or the spirit of the rice. That's why in this illustration you can see some farmers with bundles of rice. The third illustration says Kaji miraculous water. Kaji is the esoteric power that Kukai gets by doing his austerities. Kukai places an 11-faced kanon, that's Avalokiteshvara, the bodhisattva of compassion, at Ogurusu in Kyoto, and water miraculously springs forth. There's lots of stories of Kukai putting his walking stick down or performing some ceremony and water coming. So today at some springs in Japan, you can find signs that say Kukai brought forth this water. The fourth picture in this scroll says that instead of ship fare, Kukai offers a calligraphic rendering of a Chinese character for boat to the ferryman at Ujigawa River. The fifth illustration says Kukai request good fortune from the water kami and takes off his shoes. So you can see above the kami there's Kukai's shoes there. The sixth illustration, Kukai gives a lecture on the Mahavarachana Sutra at Kumedera Temple. That's where he originally found the Mahavarachana Sutra, in a dream or because someone told him it was there. The seventh illustration shows that Kukai does a relic burying ceremony during the groundbreaking for Nanendo Hall at Kofukuji Temple for Fujiwara Fuyutsugu, who lived from 775 to 826. He was one of the heads of state at the time. Kofukuji is a Hosso or Yogacara temple. It's also the family temple of the Fujiwara family in Nara. The eighth illustration said, scenic spot, field for growing enlightenment, enshrines treasures imported from the three countries, Japan, China, and India, and Yamato's Muroji Temple. The ninth illustration is two disciples. Kukai has granted national recognition of two disciples. The tenth illustration is of Kukai's disciple, Shinyo Shino, that means Prince Shinyo. The crown prince pays respect to Kukai's proper ethical conduct in according with the precepts. So this is Crown Prince Takaoka, who lived 799 to 865. He became one of Kukai's 10 great disciples and received the ordination name Shinyo. He went to China to study, but by the time he got there, he found that Buddhism was being discriminated against, and he was unable to find a suitable teacher in Chang'an, the capital where Kukai had studied, so he set sail for India. But unfortunately, his shipwreck and he died. One story said he survived the shipwreck, but was eaten by a tiger. Shinyo may have become Kukai's successor if he had lived, especially in light of the fact that he had those political connections, he was the crown prince, but also if he had returned from India with esoteric documents, it would have changed Japanese history. at Mount Koya today, there's a Shinyo Shino temple as part of the Mount Koya temple complex. It's a training hall. The 11th illustration is called Contemplation Dharma, Free from Obstacles. And Kukai describes and writes down the auspicious water wheel contemplation and the Funji Kan contemplation. That's contemplation of the character or sound Fun. Today it's called Funban Kaji. And Kaji is that power of incantation. And it's part of the water sprinkling Kaji incantation. But during Kukai's time, these were separate. What's done during this Funji Kan is that various mudras are formed, including the Vajra prayer mudra. You often see the Dalai Lama doing this Vajra mudra. And a triangle is formed with your hands together like that. And equilateral triangles formed for the kanjo, the sprinkling of water that takes place on top of the trainee's head. And then that's turned upside down to form an inverted triangle, which is symbolic of the navel chakra. The 12th illustration shows Kukai provides oil for a meditating and begging monk. A rock swells up and oil pours forth as a result of Kukai's kaji power.
Number 6. Daishi founds Einichi-ji. Einichi-ji is one of the five temples that enshrines the medicine Buddha Yakushi Norai in Aizu, the westernmost of the three regions of Fukushima Prefecture. Of course, we know Fukushima Prefecture because of the nuclear power plant problem. There's a legend about the construction of these five Yakushi Norais, these medicine Buddhas, called the Aizu Go Yakushi, the five medicine Buddhas. The legend says, long time ago, in the land of Aizu, the people there were constantly harassed by monsters living on Mount Bondi. They also blocked the sun and crops couldn't grow. As a result, people became ill and sickness was there for a long time. Hearing this, the imperial court dispatched Kobodaishi Kukai to Aizu. Kobodaishi defeated the monsters with his Dharma power. Again, this could be a reference to, as we saw with the Tengu, some marginalized priest that lived there, or it could be monsters. And after he defeated these monsters, he decided to create the five Yakushi Norai statues. That's the five medicine Buddha statues, and prayed for the health and well-being of the people there, and for the abundance of the five grains, the crops that they grew there. However, just before completion, the imperial court ordered him to return to the capital, and so another monk named Tokuitsu finished the work. So if you look at the founding of the temples today, these temples say that Tokuitsu founded the temples. Tokuitsu built five temples in various places of Aizu and enshrined five Yakushi Norai. These five are north, south, east, west, and center, just like you would find on a mandala. There's no proof that Kukai ever went to Aizu, and Tokuitsu is typically considered to have been an opponent of Kukai. Tokuitsu was a leader of one of the branches of the Hosso sect, that's the Yogacara sect, and Tokuitsu opposed Saicho in opening his Bodhisattva ordination platform, which was independent of Nara Buddhist establishment, and Tokuitsu was part of that Nara Buddhist establishment that controlled who could be ordained as a Buddhist. Saicho was also antagonistic towards Kukai, so they were considered rivals, and Tokuitsu definitely opposed Saicho. However, the reason that people say that Tokuitsu opposed Kukai, even if to a lesser degree than he did Saicho, is that Tokuitsu is known to have written some questions to Kukai about his Mikyo, or esoteric school of Buddhism. One of the questions, for example, is, how can the Dharmakaya Buddha, Mahavarachana, or Dainichi Norai, be communicating with you? How can the universe be talking to you? Because, according to Tokuitsu and the Yogacara school, at the highest level of truth, there's no language. So Kukai later addressed this problem or this issue in three writings that he made at the end of his life. But I think that this doesn't prove that Tokuitsu was antagonistic towards Kukai, but this is the nature of Buddhist argumentation and the development of Buddhist philosophy. There's a theory that some people on the internet have that since the Aizu Go Yakushi, the five medicine Buddhas temples, are now part of Shingon Buddhism,
it's possible that when those temples converted to Shingon, they created the story about Kukai started them, but Tokuitsu finished them. Some of these temples we know became affiliated with Shingon during the Kamakura period, which was 1185 to 1333, and the illustrated scrolls of Kukai were created at the end of the Kamakura period, so it's possible that they included this legend of Kukai. This does not appear in his earlier biographies. There's no mention that Kukai founded these temples. The second illustration, Kukai sets up the temple boundaries at Rosenji Temple in Oshu, Shinobu Province, which is currently Fukushima Prefecture, and defeats a demon. There's another Jozenji Temple in Shikoku. It's temple number one on the pilgrimage to 88 temples in Shikoku. And according to that temple's legend, which is different than the one here, in fact, this legend doesn't appear in this biography at all, Kukai visited this temple in 815 and stayed there for 21 days to practice. During that time, he had a vision of Buddha speaking at Vulture Peak in India and felt like Vulture Peak, the sacred mountain in India where Buddha gives the talk on the Lotus Sutra and other things, that mountain was transferred and moved to Japan. So this is current mythology in Rosenji Temple in Shikoku. The main temple there in Shikoku has a Buddha image that's not displayed to the public, and it has a bowl in its left hand, and it's said to have been carved by Kukai. It was open to the public viewing for 4 months in 2014, but otherwise it remains hidden. Illustration number three, Shakyamuni Buddha appears at Sanuki Byobuga Ura. That Shakyamuni appears to Kukai and Kukai reveres him and receives him, and afterwards this place changes its name. The mountain is called Gahaishizan Mountain. This is also the mountain where Kukai allegedly threw himself off, remember, from the first scroll. It's near Temple 73, that's Shushakuji, which means Shaku, the Buddha, Shakyamuni, appears. The fourth illustration says, buried a former sword in Kenzan Mountain in Sanuki. Sanuki is in Kagawa Prefecture today of Shikoku. Illustration number five, Zenzuji framed picture. Yunyang Master, that's Ommyoji Seimei, reveres a framed picture that Kobodaishi drew and changes his path. So I don't know if this is supposed to be the Ommyoji Abe no Seimei that appears in the movies Ommyoji, but Seimei's years are 921 to 1005, so it wouldn't be the time when Kukai lived. However, he could have viewed a picture that Kukai drew later, but if so, this is out of chronological order. But I'm going to make a guess that the illustrated scroll might be putting these events in order of the temples. So in other words, there were several illustrations from Fukushima, and now there are several illustrations from around Zenzuji. This is also the place where Kukai was born. Illustration number six. At a rotting bridge in Toshu Province, which is today's Kochi Prefecture in Shikoku, he gives the three refuges, that is, before him people took three refuges, that is, I take refuge in the Buddha, I take refuge in the Sangha, I take refuge in the Dharma, which makes you a Buddhist. Kukai gave these three refuges on a bridge of decaying wood in Tosa and gave a talk about being firm and solid. Illustration number seven, Harmony of Heaven and Earth Calligraphy. The story says that Kukai was offered lodging from the wife of a disciple of the Bodhisattva Gyoki, and in thanks he carved the characters Harmony of Heaven and Earth on a pillar. To elaborate on the story a little, it says that once when Kukai was traveling in a remote area, he asked for a lodging at the home of an older widow woman. When she saw Kukai there at her door, she exclaimed, "You're finally here! I've been waiting for a long time!" And then she went on to explain that her husband had told her that one day, on a certain day, a great bodhisattva would arrive at her door. This connects Kukai with Gyoki, as if Gyoki or his disciple would know that Kukai was coming. Illustration number eight, Ōmine ascetic practices. Kukai undertook Ōmine ascetic training following a deep vow that an ascetic attendant had made in the mountains that he ran into. Ōmine training today means doing a long walk in the Kumano Mountains, which is a UNESCO World Heritage hiking site below Mount Koya or near Mount Koya. This is a known practice that Shugendo people undertake, Shugendo or mountain ascetics, and it's called Omine Shugyo, in other words, Omine ascetic training. Part of this route where this training takes place, this walking takes place, is along a path that's called Suzukake no Michi. And it's just another name for the Mount Koya Omine training road. It's the old traditional pilgrimage route that connects Mount Koya to the sacred mountains where the ascetic training takes place. This path is not used that much today, but some of the Shikoku Henro go up to Mount Koya by walking along this path. I've seen the path, but I haven't walked it before, but I want to walk it. People tell me that it takes 1 or 2 days to walk from the bottom of the mountain to the top of the mountain at Mount Koya, where the temple complex is, and that it's a pretty tough hike. Illustration number 9. Kukai chants a revival mantra for a boy who died in Otori-gun in Izumi, which is modern-day Sakai and Osaka Prefecture, and Kukai revives him. So my comment on this is, what? Some people that have written about Lazarus, that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, have said that this is a defining miracle, that other people were doing miracles like getting lame people to walk and blind people to see, but raising from the dead takes it to another level. And I think that if Kukai had raised somebody from the dead, first of all, I feel that it would have appeared in one of his early biographies, Deshone, if not his autobiographical stuff, that might have said, yeah, one time I raised this guy from the dead. And furthermore, if Kukai had raised somebody from the dead, it seems to me that those opponents, you know, Saicho and Tokuitsu that I mentioned, would have nothing. I mean, it would be like, oh yeah? What, did you ever raise anybody from the dead? Illustration number 10. Appreciating cattle talk. That's what it says. At a beach in Sumiyoshi in Setsu, which is the former province that covers part of modern-day Osaka, he receives a talk from a calf. I wonder if this is related to a Buddhist sutra that's called King Gondo Sutra, because in that sutra there's this King Gondo who listens to the speech of a cow. And just to tell you the story quickly, the cow's grazing in a rice field, and the rice farmer hits the cow on one of his horns with a hammer. The cow runs to the king crying for help. The king's able to understand animal language because of his kingly status, and the king says, don't worry, cow, I'll go avenge this wrong that this guy's done to you. And then, after talking to the cow a little bit, he realizes that it's not right to return violence for violence. As he goes on, the cow asks the king, can you save me? Can you save me even from death with your riches? And the king admits that he cannot save him from death. And then they realize, then your kingliness and your riches aren't really the ultimate good. The king converts to Buddhism. Illustration number 11. Kukai does an all-day contemplation of thought meditation at the west gate of the Temple of the Four Heavenly Kings. Illustration number 12. Kukai does a Kaji incantation to dispel a demon at Rusenji in Osaka. Rusenji is Dragon Spring Temple. According to this illustration, when Kukai does this incantation, the dragon spring water gushes out. Another story of Kukai bringing spring water. It's also reported that Kukai visited Rusenji Temple in 823 and brought rain by incantations, and that the ponds in the precincts were flooded with water. At that time, because of the flood, 3 small islands were formed, and it's said that Kukai built small shrines, enshrined 4 Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, or Kami, including the protective ox-headed emperor. This makes me wonder, since it's ox-headed emperor, that's an esoteric metaphor that protects people from evil. I wonder if this is any way related to the ox or the cow that spoke a couple of illustrations back. Scroll number 8, illustration number 1, bringing rain in 824 in Shinsen-en Garden, connected to the Heian Palace, used as a private garden by the emperor. Today, Shinsen-en is a Shingon Buddhist temple located south of the Nijo Castle, approximately in the center of modern-day Kyoto. We already saw in illustration 4 of the third scroll that the monk Shubin of Yamashinadera, later called Kofukuji Temple in Nara, was first ordered to bring rain
and after a week of trying, he became jealous when Kukai seemed to do so. This is repeated in the next illustration. Kukai wrote a poem about rain falling and Shinsennin, but he doesn't mention Shubin or say that he brought it. Illustration 2. Shubin yields. Shubin concedes in the competition with Kukai to bring rain. The repetition of this that we already saw in scroll 3 might indicate that something's going on in the monastic rivalries in the 14th century when the illustrated scroll was composed. About 100 years before it was composed, we can see more of a rivalry between Buddhist sects when Nichiren, who lived 1222 to 1282, wrote in his On Repaying the Debt of Gratitude the following. Let us turn now to the great teacher Kobo. At the time of the great drought in the second month of the first year of Tencho, 824, the emperor ordered Shubin to pray for rain, and within 7 days Shubin was able to make rainfall. But the rain fell only in the capital and did not extend to the countryside. Kobo was then ordered to take over the prayers for rain, but 7 days passed and there was no sign of it. Another 7 days passed, and there still were no clouds. After 7 more days had passed, the emperor ordered Wake no Mazuna to go and present offerings in Shinsennin Garden, whereupon rain fell from the sky for a period of 3 days. The great teacher Kobo and his disciples thereupon proceeded to appropriate this rain and claim it as their own, and for more than 400 years now, it's been known as Kobo's rain. Americans tend to think that this kind of backbiting doesn't or shouldn't happen in Buddhism, as seen in Nichiren's writing and in the illustrated scrolls. In fact, historically and today, monastics are some of the harshest critics of one another, regardless of the Vinaya's prohibition on causing discord in the Sangha. Illustration number 3. Kukai lectures on the Humane King Sutra at Toji Temple in Kyoto in 825. Illustration number 4. Conducts rituals in the Futama, two-pillar room, in the east part of Seidyoden, where the emperor held meetings at the palace. Kukai conducted a Buddhist service involving Kanon, that's Avalokitesvara, the Bodhisattva of Compassion, there every month beginning in 825. Illustration 5. Banishes demons that cause epidemics. He did this for the sickness of State Minister Yoshifusa's family. Also, in the caption of this illustration, it says, Daishi gives Shinzai a 5-pointed vajra and ninju, Buddhist prayer beads, and appoints him as temple administrator. Illustration number 6. Comforted by Hui Go. Becoming sick, Kukai resigns from his government post as high priest in 831. He faces a picture of Hui Go for Kaji power, as he had promised to do. Illustration number 7. Kukai establishes Shuge Shuchien School around 829 at Toji Temple. This is the first non-government university in Japan, and it's open to everybody. This school still exists today. This is also one of the few things we can verify is actually happening that's depicted in these 10 scrolls. Scroll number 9. The first illustration is creates and performs the latter 7 days imperial ritual in the first month of 834. This ritual, known as the Goshichinichi Mishuho, which means the latter 7 day honored Dharma practice, was established at the imperial palace to protect the nation and to sanctify the emperor as a Chakravardhan king, the universal monarch. The ritual was held annually at the imperial palace during the second week of the new year, and took place at the same time as the esoteric Gosaie, the state-sponsored new year ritual at the palace. In 834, Kukai petitioned Emperor Ninmyo to add the ritual, and it was held in a temporary location in 835. The Shingon Inn, Shingon Monastery, was built at the palace for the purpose of doing the latter 7 day ritual in 836, a year after Kukai's death. Illustration number 2. Final admonitions to his disciples. Kukai gives all of his disciples at each temple instructions in 834. Illustration number 3. Nujo, his bodily remains. Kukai enters Nujo sitting in the lotus position. As I mentioned,
Nujo is long-term samadhi. While this is a euphemism for death, generally in Buddhism, Shingon followers and pilgrims in Shikoku typically hold that Kukai is still alive and that he's sitting in Nujo, long-term samadhi, waiting for Maitreya, the next Buddha. This is known as Kobodaishi Shinko, Kobodaishi faith. Illustration number 4, Emperor Saga, who reigned 809 to 823, has a mourning ceremony. On that occasion, arrangements were made for Kukai's funeral. Illustration number 5, posthumously granted the rank of Yamato's high priest of Dharma Mudra. Illustration number 6, Daishi appears in a dream had by Jikaku Daishi, who is Ennin, 794 to 864. Ennin was one of the 8 people to go to Tongchina and bring back esoteric text. He consciously gathered and returned with scriptures that Saicho and Kukai did not bring back from China, and subsequently led to new translations, which contributed to the development of Japanese esoteric Buddhism. Illustration number 7, opening the door and cutting Kukai's hair in Mount Koya. There's a legend that sometime after Kukai's Nujo, some people opened the door and went into Kukai's tomb or meditation room. They touched his knee and found that it was still warm. His hair was grown, and so they cut his hair. Illustration number 8, conferring the posthumous honorific title Kobodaishi, the great master who propagated the Dharma. He receives this title from Emperor Daigo, who reigned 897 to 930. Scroll number 10, illustration 1, embodiment of Sumiyoshi Myojin. Kukai is identified as being the same as the Shinto Kami Sumiyoshi by Emperor Murakami, who reigned 946 to 967. This is part of Honji Suijaku, that is identifying Shinto Kami with Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, which Kukai promoted. This also deifies Kukai. Sumiyoshi Myojin is a Kami of navigation and poetry. This name, Sumiyoshi Myojin, is called one of the 10 epitaphs of Kukai. Buddha also has 10 epitaphs. Illustration number 2. The priest Hatake has a prophetic dream of Kukai. Hatake was a priest of Fukoji in the prefecture of Kawachi, and he's not seen anywhere else except in this manuscript. Illustration number 3. Historical ruins manifestation. Toji priest Enmi, or maybe it's pronounced Amy, while visiting Zenzuji Temple in Shikoku, sees an appearance of Kobodaishi's writings. After leaving the capital and going to Zenzuji, he had an unexpected vision of a letter penned by Kukai, saying that he was in the pure land of Maitreya's Zushita heaven. Illustration number 4. Fujiwara no Michinaga, 966 to 1028, does a temple visit to Mount Koya and worships Kobodaishi in front of his mausoleum. Michinaga was one of the heads of state, and after he visits Mount Koya in 1027, Nujo belief, that is, Kukai is still alive in long-term samadhi, spread widely. Illustration number 5, Taira no Kiyomori, 1118 to 1181, who in the late Heian period established the first samurai-dominated administrative government in Japanese history, repairs the Daito, that is, the stupa on Mount Koya. Kiyomori is the main character depicted in the Japanese classic Tales of the Heikei, which some have analyzed as having a strong Shingon influence. Kiyomori also is depicted in many movies and in a Japanese television series that was popular a few years ago. Illustration number 6, Emperor's visit to Mount Koya. Mount Koya becomes Japan's Pure Land and home of a living Buddha, Kukai. Successive emperors afterwards visit Mount Koya as well.